Okay. Good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for attending this morning. My name is Shauna Pelly, and I'm the Capacity Building Programs Director with Fuse Social. Super excited about today's topic, understanding climate risk and vulnerability. So we'll just dive right in and we'll start with our land acknowledgement. So for those of us who are viewing this session today locally in Wood Buffalo, I would like to acknowledge that we are stationed on Treaty 8 territory. Oh, sorry. I had a thing come up here. Just one moment. Sorry about that. Ancestral and traditional territory of the Cree, Dene, and Métis people. I'm thankful for these borrowed lands along with the traditional teachings and lessons of resilience they offer us in spirit of maintaining good relations with others for future generations. And I would like to introduce you today to Laura Lines, who is the president of the Resilience Institute, and she'll be speaking a little bit more to our session today.
Thank you so much. And thank you for Fuse for hosting this. As she said, I'm Laura and I'm with the Resilience Institute. We are located all over the place. We've worked quite a bit up in Fort McMurray and we're just delighted to be part of this initiative with Fuse Social and the Red Cross. The Resilience Institute is a charitable organization and our mandate is pretty simple. It's education and research. Working with communities, businesses, organizations on climate change adaptation and mitigation. We've been focusing a lot of our work on most vulnerable communities, many Indigenous communities, and in the resilience building, which is a combination often of both adaptation and mitigation. So I'm delighted today to introduce our first speaker, who is also one of our board members. We're so privileged to have Dr. David Sauchyn. He's director of the Prairie Adaptation Research Collaborative at the University of Regina, professor of geography and environmental studies, and is the lead author of the most recent Prairie chapter of the National Assessment of Climate Change. It was just released in 2020. So Dave has worked all over the world and across Prairie provinces. He is going to talk today about some projections and just information that will be relevant, I think, to Wood Buffalo region. So I'm really looking forward to Dave's presentation. And with that, I'm going to turn it over. And anybody who has questions, if you could just put them in the chat and we'll get to as many as possible before our next speaker.
Thanks, Laura, for that kind introduction. I'll just load my presentation here. Okay, can everybody see my presentation and hear me? Good. Well, thanks a lot for this opportunity to speak. I want to thank the sponsors. Since I'll be talking for nearly an hour, I'll be hydrating periodically from my Resilience Institute water bottle. And I'm going to begin this presentation on understanding climate risks and vulnerability with images of two relatively recent extreme weather events. You'll probably recognize them, the flood in southern Alberta in 2013. And of course, the fire at Fort Mac in 2016. And I'm highlighting these two events because of their severity, but also because we featured these in our Prairie chapter in the National Assessment of Climate Change that Laura just referred to. The National Assessment is otherwise known as Canada in a Changing Climate, Advancing Our Knowledge for Action. So if you Google that title, you'll come across the regional chapters, and the first one to be published is the Prairie Provinces chapter. Chapters on each of the other provinces will be forthcoming early next year. Well, because I was lead author, I chose the, and I had, by the way, I had 14 co-authors, great co-authors, many of whom are based in Alberta, but I chose to write the section of the report on floods, drought, and wildfires. Now, keep in mind, this is a scientific assessment, so we didn't do new research. Rather, we reviewed everything that's been written about the topic of climate change in the Prairie provinces. We reviewed something like 300 reports and publications. Many of those were on the topic that I chose to review. And the conclusion that I drew was that the warming of the climate is amplifying these extreme events. And that the impacts of flooding, drought, and wildfire has been unprecedented in recent years. And yet the climate models and the climate research suggests that we can expect an increased risk from these types of extreme weather events. Well, I've got a bit of a background in these extreme events because in 1974, when I graduated from the University of Alberta, I was looking for new skiing opportunities. So I applied to the University of Colorado for graduate studies. Little did I know, I was unaware of the fact that the same year, the state legislature had passed a bill that required all of the counties to produce natural hazard maps. So when I got to Colorado in the fall of 1975, I was offered a job, believe it or not, hiking the mountains of Colorado for 2 years producing these maps. It was a dream job for my fellow grad students and I, and you can see some of the photos of the many photos I took, a snow avalanche on the left and a debris flow and flash flood deposit on the right. And we produced the type of maps by hand in the center pane, in the center image. So those numbers refer to different types of natural hazards. Notice all the wood debris. We use, to some extent, we use the wood and the tree rings to give us an indication of the timing of these events. And so this was my first experience using tree rings to study the environment, but I'll come back to that. While I was a student there, I was encouraged to take a course from this professor. And I only knew him as this old guy, this old dude who was spending the latter part of his career in Colorado. He had moved there from the University of Chicago. And after I'd taken a course from him, I discovered that he's perhaps the most famous geographer of the 20th century. Gilbert White is considered the father of floodplain management. And he's credited with saying that floods are an act of God, but flood losses are largely an act of man. So he considered the role of communities and institutions and individuals in exposing themselves to flood hazards. He advocated that we accommodate flood hazards rather than preventing them. And so he was a strong advocate of restricting land use in floodplains. And when I took the course from Gilbert White, he sent the class out onto the floodplain of Boulder Creek, where we spoke to residents. And I learned by going door to door that people had been exposed to floods, but had no intention of leaving, that this was their home, and they didn't expect another flood because a flood had occurred, and they thought it would be 100 years until the next 100-year flood, which is, of course, a misconception. He did his PhD research at the University of Chicago. His dissertation, Human Adjustments to Floods, perhaps one of the most cited publications in geography and environmental studies. And he argued that there was an over-reliance on engineering works to prevent damage from floods. And in fact, he argued that these structural works had actually increased the damage. He passed away in 2006. And so he was still alive when his prophetic words were realized and the breaching of the dikes on the Mississippi Delta caused all the incredible damage from Hurricane Katrina. I want to highlight one other key message from our Prairies chapter. We had six key messages. I already told gave you the one about extreme events, but Deborah Davidson from the U of A and a couple colleagues reviewed the literature on the social vulnerability to climate change on the prairies and highlighted they wrote this key message that highlighted the fact that any kind of existing social inequities would be exacerbated by climate change. So the most vulnerable people are the same people that are vulnerable to other catastrophes like the pandemic, Indigenous people, women, and so on. And that so these social groups have unique vulnerabilities, but they also have agency. They also have unique strengths that they bring to withstanding and coping and adapting to climate change. And that role, that social economic dimension is embedded in the definition of climate risk. So here's a conceptual framework where risk is seen as the intersection of vulnerability to climate risks, exposure to climate risks, and the hazard itself. And the vulnerability and exposure are a function of a number of different characteristics of the community and of the individuals. But for the purpose of this talk, I'm going to focus on the hazards themselves because that's my area of expertise. And specifically on the natural variability of the climate versus anthropogenic climate change and the interaction between those two components of our climate. This diagram is from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the IPCC. And that organization just this past August released their sixth assessment report. So every 5 to 7 years, a large group of scientists, thousands of scientists, do the same thing we did for the Canadian government. They review everything that's known about climate change and they produce these massive reports. The first one was in 1990. I'm involved in the IPCC as an expert reviewer, but there are thousands of scientists who contribute to the IPCC. And I'm sure you saw the media coverage. This was a very prominent report. And I've extracted, 5 quotes from a report that's thousands of pages in length. The full report, there is a smaller version called the technical summary, and there's even a smaller version called the summary for policymakers, which is the version that the vast majority of people would read. So first of all, in the upper right, the statement that the human influence on our climate is unequivocal and that the observed warming of recent decades can be fully explained by human factors with little explanation or little contribution from nature. And likewise, as with temperature, we can explain some of the change in a precipitation in terms of human influence. So whereas it's unequivocal with temperature, it's likely with precipitation that humans are modifying the climate. And then the next three bullets are of greater relevance here, and that's what they concluded about extreme weather events. Beginning with temperature, that it's extremely likely that the intensity and frequency in North America of hot extremes has increased compared to the recent past, and virtually certain that there's been an increase compared to the pre-industrial period. And then the next two bullets are concerning excess water and water deficits. And in both cases with high confidence, the IPCC has concluded that a warmer climate increases moisture transport into the weather systems and therefore wet seasons and events are getting wetter. They're being amplified. But conversely, the same heat that drives moisture into the air is extracting moisture from the soil. So the likelihood of drought also is amplified by a warming climate. So we get an exaggeration or an amplification of both types of weather extremes, excess water and water deficits. Well, you know, it's remarkable that they use language like unequivocal, because scientists are never absolutely certain, despite the public perception. Because, and especially when it comes to the study of the climate system, because it is complex and chaotic. It's global in extent. It's complex and it has a large number of moving parts that are interacting. And it's chaotic in that a small perturbation to one part of the system causes a chain reaction and causes changes in other parts of the system. And that's important to keep in mind, because actually human beings are only directly changing two parts of the system. We're changing biogeochemical cycles, and in particular, the carbon cycle. And we're changing the surface of the earth. And we're changing the capacity of soils and vegetation to sequester carbon. That's really most of the change we're causing, and yet it's resulting in a change to the entire climate system because of its chaotic nature and all the feedbacks, and in particular positive feedbacks, where a change in the system causes a chain reaction that amplifies the change. For example, out on the far left, there's some feedbacks going on where as the ocean heats up, it produces more evaporation, more clouds, more precipitation, which traps more heat next to the earth. Also, in the cryosphere, in the part of the earth that consists of snow and ice, well, the cryosphere is shrinking rapidly. As the earth heats up, sea ice is disappearing, glaciers are disappearing, snow is disappearing. And that is resulting in further warming of the climate, because these white surfaces reflect the sun's radiation back into space. And if you remove these white surfaces, it leads to a further heating of the climate. Let's consider, however, what exactly we mean, or at least what a scientist means by climate and climate change. Because when you mention climate change to a lot of people, they think of government policy, they think of intergenerational justice, they think of social justice, they think of the threats to human beings, but actually the climate also exists independent of people. Even if people weren't here, there would still be a climate on Earth. So scientists think of climate as the weather that you expect. The weather is the actual conditions on a given day. So I've used two images from Calgary, both from 2015. On January the 25th, it was 17 degrees in Calgary. On August 22nd, it was 4 degrees and snowing. This was the weather, but it's not the weather you expect. The climate of Calgary in January usually is relatively cold, and the climate of August, the weather you expect, is warm. The climate is the statistics of the weather, the average conditions, the range of conditions in the weather at a particular time of year. And I also like to use these two quotes. I was picking up a rental car at the Calgary airport, and the young woman that gave me the car said, you know, I just got a call from Texas, and the customer wants to know what kind of weather they can expect in Calgary in April. What do you say? What do you tell them? What do you tell the person what to bring in terms of luggage? Calgary, bring your shorts and bring your parka. Because that is Calgary weather. But the climate in April is extremely variable. And the other quote was from a manager of an irrigation district in southern Alberta. I gave a talk in Tabor, Alberta on climate change to an interesting audience of Southern Alberta agricultural producers, and they were quite polite. They didn't believe most of what I said, but that's okay. But they were kind and polite. And afterwards, this fellow came up and said, you know, Dave, nice talk, but I'll believe in climate change when we get weather we don't expect. And I said, wow, can I quote you? That's brilliant. Because that is the definition of climate change, weather we don't expect. Not once, but again and again and again. And that seems to be occurring. We can also make a distinction between weather and climate change in terms of the scale over time and space. So on the far left, whereas weather occurs on the scale of hours to days and weeks, and it occurs at a specific location, climate change on the far right transpires over decades to centuries. In fact, climate change doesn't exist until you have decades of data. You can't make any kind of conclusion about the what the weather is doing until you have decades of data. And also, climate change occurs over the entire world. You can't talk about the weather of the whole world. That's ridiculous. You only talk about the weather at a particular location, but climate change is affecting the entire world. And then there's a transition in between where we get variation in the climate on the scale of months to decades, affecting large parts of the world, like Canada. And that natural climate variability is driven by oscillations in the atmosphere and the ocean, and in particular, the ocean. Oceans drive our climate variability. And you're probably familiar with El Nino, the Southern Oscillation, and its other phase, La Nina. We are currently entering a La Nina. Depending on the phase of ENSO, we get wetter or drier or warmer or colder conditions. And then there's also a circulation of the Pacific Ocean over longer time frames of decades, which results in decades of wetter or drier conditions. And then there's a switch in the phase of the PDO, and we tend to get wetter conditions at a decadal scale. It's fairly important that we recognize this climate variability because it can be confused with climate change. If we flip from, say, a wetter decade to a drier decade, some people can conclude that the climate has changed. No, not necessarily. It could be simply that decadal scale climate variability. Another way to look at it is over time. In this case, from 1948 to 2018, this is the temperature at the surface of the Earth over that time period, beginning with the whole world. So this is an average for thousands of weather stations. And over that time period, just those decades, the Earth has warmed by 0.8 degrees. But the natural variability fluctuates from year to year, but notice that it's relatively small at the global scale, because if it's warm on one part of the Earth, it might be cold someplace else, which kind of cancels out. So there's relatively little indication of natural variability if you consider the full climate system, as opposed to considering Canada. And when you scale down to a country, even a country the size of Canada, there's just much more natural variability from year to year, but there's also more climate change, 1.9 degrees over that same time period. And if we scale down again to part of Canada, in particular Northern Canada, there's even more natural variability, but also no place on Earth is warming faster than Northern Canada. So here's another way to think in terms of what is climate change. That's the trend, the long-term trend, as opposed to the short-term climate variability. And another way to look at the warming of Canada over that time period is using maps, because these maps show that the degree of warming has not been uniform across the country. The areas in pale yellow have hardly warmed at all. That's the eastern provinces. But the areas in red and especially dark red have warmed by 3 to 4 degrees, and that would be Western Canada, and in particular, Northwestern Canada, and especially in winter. So this report from Environment and Climate Change Canada concluded that Canada is warming at twice the rate of the entire world. Here is the rate of global warming. This is the average temperature of the whole world every month from 1880 right up to a couple months ago, September 2021. If it was a cold month, it's in blue. If it's a warm month, it's in red. It's pretty obvious that ever since the mid-1970s, every single month, with one tiny exception, has been warmer than the 20th century average. That one exception, I think it's December 1984, was a cool month, but every other month, and not only warmer than average, but increasingly warmer than average, this progressive increase. And that's why we call it global warming, because the signal, the indication of climate change is strongest at the global scale. It's unequivocal. However, of course, we don't think globally. You don't grab your phone, you don't grab the weather app on your phone and say, okay, what's the temperature of the world today? We're concerned about what's happening where we live. Now that warming, that global warming is occurring mostly in the oceans because most of the Earth is ocean. 3/4 of the Earth is ocean. This is an iconic image from space of Turtle Island. Turtle Island surrounded by the Pacific and Atlantic and Arctic oceans. And this is where most of our weather originates. And in this particular image from space, you can see three weather systems forming over the Pacific Ocean. That's these swirling clouds. And they're passing right over Western Canada, bringing heat and moisture. And so a lot of the impact of global warming in our part of the world is the heating of the ocean and the delivery of more water to Western Canada. But those weather systems don't necessarily arrive in Western Canada. Those same weather systems could take a trajectory that takes them over, say, the southern US, in which case we get no precipitation in a warmer climate. And so the heating of the earth and the heating of the oceans is resulting in both in more precipitation and less precipitation at the same time, or wetter conditions and drier conditions. This is the way to think about it, or at least this is the way scientists think about it, that we can define if climate is the statistics of weather, then climate change is any statistically significant shift in weather statistics. And really there are three types of weather statistics. There's the average conditions. So any kind of shift in the mean or median of temperature, precipitation, wind, humidity, and so on. So when we talk about 2 degrees of global warming, we're talking about a shift in the average. But also there is a shift in the amplitude of the variability and a shift in the intensity and the probability of extreme events. And if you're familiar with these types of bell curves, here is a bell curve that we generated for Alberta, for central Alberta, for summer precipitation. The green curve is three recent decades, so this is historical data. And so for this part of Alberta, it's actually the foothills and mountains. They get about 700 millimeters of precipitation in a year, but it can range from 500 to about almost 900. But in the future, the statistical distribution is quite different. In blue, the three decades starting this year, and then in red the three decades beginning in 2051. And notice how the curve is flattened. It's also shifted to the right, so there's actually more precipitation on average, but not much more. But really the big difference is the flattening of the curve and the stretching of the tails. So the range of precipitation from the driest to the wettest years is much larger in the future. And this is probably the biggest challenge we face, is dealing with that amplification of the intensity and probability of extreme events and the increased range of conditions between wet and dry. That's in contrast, and I mean, if you read what's in the news, what do you hear about? You hear about the calving of the Antarctic and Greenland ice sheets. You hear about the melting of Arctic sea ice. And as a result of both of those, the sea levels are rising. And you hear about pollution in big cities. Well, to a large extent, this is not relevant in our part of the world. We don't have a shoreline in Alberta. The sea ice is in the Arctic. We have mountain glaciers, but we don't have ice sheets. And even though we get heat extremes, we don't get the kind of smog they do, for example, in Beijing. So don't be misled by what you see in the newspaper, especially the national newspaper, because the biggest climate change in Alberta is the warming of the winter. This is minimum winter temperature at Edmonton back to 1880, fantastic temperature record, right up to last year. So this is in winter, and this is the daily minimum. This is the temperature experience when right at sunrise. It's gone way up from an average of minus 22 to an average of close to minus 15. It's gone up by almost 7 degrees, which is a huge climate change. And even though we love to whine and complain about winter, in the past, it was quite a bit colder. Now that might sound like your parents or grandparents talking about how much worse it was. Well, this is the statistics. We're looking right at the statistics. The last time Edmonton had a really cold winter was 1969. So Alberta is getting much less cold. In 1969, I was there. I was in school in Edmonton, and every kid got a certificate from the Edmonton Journal because it was a long, cold winter, but there were 26 days in particular in which the temperature didn't get above minus 21. And there were 21 days below minus 30 out of 26. So it's just inconceivable. It's just hard to imagine that severity and duration of cold in our current climate. And the other characteristic of Alberta's climate is the frequency of these weather disasters. This is data from the Insurance Bureau of Canada. And these are the 10 most costly weather disasters in all of Canada back to 1983. 6 of the 10 are in Alberta. And of the top 20, 16 are in Alberta, or at least the prairies. And that's because the prairies has a climate that's characterized by extreme events. And in particular, in Alberta, people are much more exposed because there are just a lot more people in Alberta than are there Saskatchewan or Manitoba. And there are two very large cities. And so people are more exposed to these events. Of course, the top weather event is the fire at Fort McMurray. And these are just the insured losses. What's conspicuous by its absence is drought. Drought isn't on this list because these are insured losses. These are direct damages. And drought tends to cause a huge loss in the productivity, especially in the ag sector. And drought tends to have impacts that are not insured. However, we can't underestimate the impact of drought. And if you were around, and if you recall the drought of 2001, 2002, it cost the economy of Canada $6 billion, most of that on the prairies. And if you have a bad memory like me, just go back and read the newspapers and you get a sense of how bad it really was. Probably the worst case scenario for Western Canada would be a drought of this magnitude, but in a warmer climate. Because a lack of water really limits what we can do, obviously. And we're in the midst of a drought. This is from the Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada Drought Watch website. This is conditions for the past 3 months. And you can see the area in brown has had less than half of the normal precipitation. And of course, not only is there a loss of productivity, but you get events like this, which is a grass fire that I happened to stumble upon a few years ago and actually got much closer, probably too close than this to take hundreds of photographs of this grass fire. But let's talk in terms of much more recent events. Starting with the heat dome. Unbelievably high temperatures this past June. And it triggered a scientific study that concluded that these temperatures were virtually impossible without human-caused climate change. They shattered the previous maximum temperatures for Canada by 4 degrees. And those maximum high temperatures actually were just down the road from where I live, Yellowgrass, Saskatchewan, just outside of Regina, was known as Canada's hotspot. And unfortunately, this small hamlet of Yellowgrass will now have to find a different claim to fame. And of course, as a result of this extreme heat, there was impacted the agricultural sector, but we know all about the forest fires and consequently the impacts of the current catastrophe in British Columbia. Unbelievable. And I'm sure scientists are already beginning to work on an attribution study. And there's no doubt that the severity of this event will be scientifically linked to a warmer climate. And in fact, there's just so much evidence now that a warmer atmosphere and a warmer ocean is producing heavier rainfall events. And that scientific evidence is as current as this month. This is an article from Scientific American. And this scientist wrote about how these vapor storms or atmospheric rivers are threatening people and property. And in the same article, the graph here shows the increase in the water vapor content of the atmosphere just back to the 1980s. Measured above oceans in blue and above land in brown. And this scientist concluded there's been a 4% increase in the humidity of the atmosphere just since the 1990s. Well, if you increase the vapor content of the atmosphere, that water vapor at some point is going to condense and fall to the earth. And it's falling to the earth in the form of more intense rainstorms. Now, rain doesn't necessarily produce flooding. It depends on a number of factors. And so when scientists convert precipitation to floods, they have to consider a large number of factors. They have to consider the watershed hydrology. They have to consider the hydraulics of the river system. And in the case of ice jam floods, they often also have to consider the thermal properties of the ice. And of course, that's relevant because of the ice jam flood in Fort McMurray just fairly recently. So when scientists say that they're virtually certain that there's heavier precipitation, that doesn't necessarily translate into we're virtually certain that there will be more flooding because it depends on the watershed. Chances are there'll be more flooding, but the extent of flooding will depend on how the precipitation gets converted into runoff and how that runoff is shed through the river system. And of course, where people are living in the watershed, how they're exposed to that runoff. But we now attribute flooding to climate change. So the flooding in southern Alberta was attributed to climate change by Maclean's magazine. And there is a few years ago, the city of Calgary constructed this pretty clever memorial in the lobby of City Hall with some muddy boots and some photographs. But that plaque suggests that this was the costliest natural disaster ever recorded in Canada. Well, that was very, very soon exceeded by the fire at Fort Mac. But also the plaque suggests that the Bow and Elbow Rivers have never been higher ever before. Well, you know, sure, poetic license and take it for what it is, but scientifically that makes no sense. In fact, the city of Calgary struck an expert panel and I was asked to participate in that panel. And so I have access to the information that we compiled. And we compiled Bow River flows back to 1879. The 2013 flood is off to the far right in red. Go off to the far left and there are two events in particular, that exceeded the 2013 flood. Now those two events from 1879 and 1987 were prior to the installation of the gauge on the Bow River. So these are from high water marks. In some of the original buildings in Calgary, there are still damage. There's still marks or evidence left on these buildings of where the Bow River was at that time. The gauge wasn't installed until 1911. So for every year since 1911, there's good data. So in fact, I mean, this was a huge event, but it wasn't unprecedented. And in fact, we have even more evidence, and it comes via the City of Calgary drought plan, because when they drafted the drought plan in 2011, its conclusions included speaking to this guy at the University of Saskatchewan. They had the wrong university, but at least they had the right person. And so they asked our lab to evaluate, in this case, the historical record of drought using tree rings. I said I'd come back to the damage of trees. Well, we've been collecting old wood from Alberta for the last several decades, because this wood, it records debris flows and avalanches where the trees are growing on steep slopes, but where the trees are growing on fairly stable slopes, it actually records the climate, because trees need heat and they need water. So here's a 1,000-year-old limber pine in the Whaleback, south of Calgary. We're taking a very small sample that doesn't affect the tree. And here's some old limber pine that died hundreds of years ago, and we can still use that wood to reconstruct the climate. And we have pieces of wood from trees that began growing in the year 542. And like I said, trees are part of the hydrological cycle. So we've reconstructed the flow of the Bow River, but also the Athabasca River, in this case, back to 1111. Now I could spend a long time, my students and I have spent decades constructing these, so I could spend a long time talking about it, but I'll just point out how the degree of excess water in blue and the degree of water deficit or drought in red varies so much from year to year, but from century to century. So in fact, the 20th century was relatively benign. I hate to say that because, I mean, my grandparents homesteaded in southern Alberta and were affected by the drought of the 30s. But if you compare the degree of drought and the degree of excess water to the period prior to the gauges, the weather gauges and water gauges, you can see that just naturally we are underestimating the degree of excess water and drought in our part of the world. Even in the absence of climate change, it could be quite a bit worse. Now you add global warming and it is exacerbating or amplifying the degree of variability. So this is the past. I'll just talk briefly about the future because it gets fairly technical, because we have no trees. We have no weather stations or water stations in the future. We have no option but to use climate models. These simulations of the climate, developing numerical equations to describe the climate, and then developing computer code so we can run these numerical simulations. And then we take the climate model, we drive it using future concentrations of greenhouse gases because humans are modifying the climate, and we get climate projections for the future. But we can't know the future, so we get a range of climate projections from a small change in blue up to a large change in red. Here are the greenhouse gas emission scenarios, all the way from a high emission scenario that assumes that humans will do nothing but continue on the current trajectory, versus a low emission scenario, which we assume that meetings like COP26 will be effective and that countries will be able to limit their emissions of greenhouse gases and everything in between. And so here are temperature projections for Alberta right up to the end of the century for those three different scenarios. A change of all the way from just less than 2 degrees, ideally, with a low emission scenario, right up to an increase of almost 6 degrees if we do nothing about our emissions of greenhouse gases. Neither of those is realistic. It's going to be somewhere in between. That's temperature, precipitation. We take model output. We extract precipitation data for every day from 1950 to the end of this century. You need a fairly fast computer and big computers, but we have those at the university. And you can see there's a fairly good upward trend in the number of days per year with more than 20 millimeters of precipitation. It's that dashed red line. But also notice how the range gets larger and larger and larger going forward, until in the future, some of the models indicate that there can be more than 6 days per year of very heavy precipitation. This is from the North Saskatchewan River Basin. A lot of our work has been in central Alberta because it's been funded quite generously by EPCOR and by the City of Edmonton, but also we're doing work in the Athabasca River Basin currently, funded by Alberta Environment and Parks. And then at the City of Calgary, once again, using daily precipitation data from the Canadian Regional Climate Model, from 1980 right out to the end of this century. And the amount of precipitation in one day is going up, but so is the range, all the way from 20 millimeters in 1 year, which is the most in that year, in excess of 100 millimeters in a single day in the future. Now, it's important to understand that this is just one simulation. If we run this model again and again and again and again, we get a different time series, a different sequence of rainstorms every time. But the statistics are the same. The number of storms of a particular size are the same. The range of values are the same. But the years in which they occur are different because this is not weather data. Remember, weather is assigned to a particular day. Climate is the statistical properties. And so that's why we can produce weather data for a particular day in the future, but every time you run the model, we get a different weather. So we have to synthesize or summarize the future weather to get climate. And if, and this is getting relatively technical, these are called IDF curves, which some people in the audience may recognize, the intensity, the duration, and the frequency of precipitation. Engineers produce these all the time because they have implications for stormwater runoff. And the IDF curve is going up. It's shifting up by 7% with each degree of global warming. And finally, we're doing work again, Central Alberta, North Saskatchewan River. This is the flow of the river. But the thing that we've discovered is that the high flows, the highest flows in the river are going up as we go forward, but also when they occur is changing. Historically in the past, the river was highest in summer and early fall from the melting of glaciers and snow fields in the Rocky Mountains. But those glaciers and snow fields are disappearing. And so in the future, the high flows are not going to be in summer. They're going to be in spring when we're getting heavy precipitation. Requiring adaptation. The amount of adaptation depends on how much the climate warms. How much the climate warms depends on how much the climate is slowed. And of course, that was the purpose of COP. So here's some of the agreements that were reached, but these are not binding agreements. They have to be translated into national policy. So that's where the work begins, where governments, federal governments, develop policy that are consistent with these international agreements. Policy includes in Canada, funding for infrastructure, but the feds now will give funds for infrastructure only if the project is viewed through a lens of climate change. And as a result, codes and standards are changing in anticipation of the kinds of climate changes that I just described. Two more slides. There's a huge demand for this type of information because all of a sudden, climate change has become a critical financial issue, a business issue. And so organizations that have climate information are being asked to assess climate risks in various sectors of the economy, to communities, to First Nations, to organizations. And the demand for that information exceeds the capacity of scientists to deliver it, because actually scientists, that's not their job. So there is this intermediate service called the Climate Service. And there's actually a new journal called Climate Service. And that was the purpose of our organization. So I'm gonna end with this slide. So if you want further information, you can contact our organization, PARC, that's actually been around for 21 years to provide information for science-based adaptation. And we like to collaborate in Alberta with the Resilience Institute. So I haven't left a whole lot of time for questions, but I think about 5 minutes if anybody has any.
You can use, okay, so we've got one coming in chat, and also feel free to use the hand feature, and I'll try to, maybe Dave, if you stop sharing the screen, I could see more people, I think. So Sarah Walsh from the Canadian Red Cross has asked, in your travels and work, are there any examples of community adaptation strategies that really stand out to you?
Yeah, for sure. There are some communities that are way ahead of the rest, and Edmonton in particular, and also Calgary. So despite the perception in the rest of Canada, of Alberta, some of the most progressive climate change actions have occurred in Alberta. I would say the most progressive communities in on the prairies would be Edmonton, Calgary, and Saskatoon. And there's some smaller communities, a lot of smaller communities like Leduc, Alberta, Selkirk, Manitoba, that have climate adaptation plans.
Gary, I see your hand up. Go ahead and unmute yourself and ask your question to Dave.
Yeah, this is a bit of a silly question here, but I got to ask it anyway. Climate change. We all know that we're going through this climate change, but I would just like to ask your feelings on, is it being caused by us? Do we have definitive proof that climate change is being caused by us, or is it just, I have friends that say it's the rotation of the earth is going off kilter or something similar to that?
Yeah, Gary, people advise me to read the internet. I don't read the internet for science because I produce science. I don't need to read what's on the internet. And if you Google climate change, and I was curious, you get 10.5 million websites. There's probably just a few hundred that are credible, and the rest of the 10.5 million are not. So I would advise you to go to the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, and if you have time, read the summary reports, because this is the work of thousands of scientists working over many, many decades. And the study of climate change goes back almost 200 years. It's not new. And so there is a huge, huge volume of consistent climate research that leads to the conclusion that there's no other explanation for the current climate change.
Thanks for that great question, Gary. I don't see anyone else's hands up, and there aren't any questions but in the chat, but if anyone else has a question, now's your time to ask it. And feel free to reach out afterwards to Dave at Park directly or to us at the Resilience Institute. We're happy. Ron, I see you're unmuted. Did you have a question?
Actually, just a comment. Earlier in the presentation, you mentioned that it seems to be human nature that we tempt our fate when it comes to environment. So when you say floodplains and you say, people say, this is my home, this is where we build. It's surprising that how much we are, or our arrogance that we say, well, this river's here, but we're going to build a right on it. And we'll dig this ditch. So if the water comes up and over, it'll go around us. And it always comes back and humbles you and says, no, it doesn't work that way. We should just really look at saying, why do you develop close to here? Why do you put it here? You know, those type of things. It's interesting.
Yeah, Ron, isn't that true? And I don't know if you've been following the news coverage of the events in BC, but some of the worst flooding is around Abbotsford in an area that used to be a lake. And in the 1920s, they drained the lake and began farming below sea level. So that area always has been extremely vulnerable to flooding.
Yeah, and it always surprises me that everybody is so surprised.
I see we have one more question, and I think we have time for it. We'll go over to Teresa Greenwood, fellow board member. Go ahead, Teresa.
Teresa. Hello. Hi, David. I just have a quick question, based on my own lived experience, having lost my house in the fire and then also flooded out when the downtown flooded last year. Is there something about our location here in Fort McMurray that makes, like, we're experiencing things a little bit earlier than, other places in Canada? Is there something about us being in the north or our geographic location that's making us particularly vulnerable to be experiencing these things a little bit ahead of the rest of the country?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, good question. Well, you saw those maps that indicated that the highest rate of global warming in Canada is in the north and the west. In fact, that's some of the fastest global warming in the entire world, but also it's the location of Fort Mac in the forest, in the southern boreal forest, and on a large river. So, you know, it's a function of the rate of global warming, but also your exposure to flooding and fire.
Thanks for that, Dave. That's a great question, Teresa. Appreciate that. And I echo the comments made by Dr. Sauchyn about the devastation that's happening right now that we're witnessing in BC. And just, I'd like to add that there has been a lot of focus on who's to blame for climate change. And those conversations are important so we understand where we can work together to solve the issues. But if we focus on who's to blame and create division, we're not going to be able to come together like we need to solve the issues, both in mitigation and adaptation. So, so if we're to blame, then what do we do moving forward? Or if we're not to blame, it's happening. Whether it matters, but it doesn't matter in some ways because it's happening, whoever's fault it is. So we'll close up now with Dave. And again, if you have any questions, feel free to add them. If something occurs to you, go ahead and put them in chat, or we can connect afterwards on that. And we'll turn our attention now to Kevin Blanchard. And he's joining us from the UK. He's the director of DRR Dynamics. And for those of you who don't know the acronym, that's Disaster Risk Reduction. So it's focused on ensuring the inclusion and empowerment of marginalized groups and disasters, risk reduction. He has 14 years of experience in developing inclusive DRR and humanitarian policy for national governments, international agencies, and NGOs. He's also the lead advocate on No Natural Disasters. So you'll see that campaign on Twitter and the website. They also have some merchandise. He also works with the wider community on the campaign to help dispel the myth that disasters are only natural and that they're beyond our control. So over to you, Kevin. Thank you so much for joining us today. Good afternoon to you.
Hello. Yes, thank you very much, Laura. And thank you, David, for such an excellent introductory presentation. I was, it was all very interesting stuff. So. Thank you. I'm just going to quickly share my screen because I have a couple of slides to share with you. okay. So as Laura just mentioned there, I'm Kevin Blanchard, and I'm here today to discuss why the term natural disasters is so problematic. And I hope by the end of this presentation, it's not very long. It's certainly shorter than David's was and less technical as well. But it's hopefully by the end of the presentation, you will have at least have some kind of questions around why it is that we use this term and why it's so widely used in media and in government reports, etc. So, as I said, I'm Kevin. I run the No Natural Disasters Twitter accounts, the website, and our merchandise operation. And I am just one of a growing number, over 5,000 followers currently on Twitter and engaging on different platforms, who are trying to spread the idea that these events or these processes aren't natural. The idea that disasters are out of our control and we have little in the way of an ability to, you know, build resilience, reduce vulnerability, increase capacity, reduce exposure, etc., I think has been proven again and again to be incorrect. These events are very much events of our own making to a degree, and I will go into some of that detail shortly. This is some of the wider team who are kind of promoting this idea that there are no such thing as natural disasters. And I'd probably like to start by saying this isn't a new argument. So the campaign as it stands currently isn't new. As you'll see here, this particular document is a letter to Voltaire from Rousseau, both very famous European kind of thinkers and philosophers back in the 1800s or 1700s, sorry, looking at the earthquake that happened in Lisbon back in 1755. And Rousseau kind of asked the question, well, nature didn't construct these buildings. Nature didn't put these buildings where they were. Nature didn't kind of create this densely populated city. So when the earthquake struck in 1755, you know, nature wasn't at fault in terms of the destruction, the death, the economic damage that was caused by this event. So, you know, the kind of the discussion and the thinking around the fact that these disasters aren't natural has been raging on for hundreds of years. But it just so happens that over the past few decades, there's been a lot more kind of concerted research from academics and kind of policymakers and professionals within the disaster risk reduction and emergency management sectors that really started to take this idea and actually develop this into a much more formed understanding of how a disaster process works and how humans as a species have a role to play in the disaster that occurs. But what is new and what's kind of I want to be talking about today, along with some of the background, is this kind of online consolidated campaign that really brings in all of this different research, all of the evidence that we have, all of the data that shows that these events aren't natural and actually helps disseminate that to what I would say is largely a non-academic crowd, because in the past, you know, academia, these types of research papers, have been quite a closed off audience in which to share these discussions and these ideas. And I think we can all agree with the advent of social media, although it's been problematic in so many ways, I think, you know, this kind of democratization of information has been a benefit. And actually we're using that within the No Natural Disasters campaign to really try to understand what it is that we as a society and as a species are doing that make these events much worse. So I think probably before we go on, it's really useful to clarify the definition of a disaster. And you know, everyone kind of hears disasters so often now. You know, it's reported almost on a daily basis. A disaster is happening around the world. And we hear this term kind of thrown about, but actually, if you look at the key definition, and this is a definition that's been developed by the International Red Cross and Red Crescent Society, it's a very common definition within this particular sector. And it's a sudden calamitous event that seriously disrupts the function of a community or a society, causes human, material, economic, or environmental losses that exceed our community's or society's ability to cope using its own resources. So I think from that definition, we can probably agree, and hopefully we do all agree, that a disaster is really when a hazard impacts on our society and impacts how it is that we are able to respond to that particular hazard. So, for example, what's happening on the west coast of Canada currently in BC, you know, that's basically a hazard. You have this storm system, intense rainfall, etc., that is impacted on society in a way that means we are unable currently to cope with the type of impacts that this particular weather system and this particular intense belt of rainfall are causing. So it's causing destruction of homes and infrastructure, etc. So it really is about us as a society and as a community that's kind of driving forward this idea of a disaster. And if we keep that in our minds, that actually it really is about us, then we can start to understand why this distinction between natural disasters or just disasters, as we would prefer, really does matter. A natural for one, and probably kind of the single most important one, it triggers this idea that no matter what we do, what decisions are taken by humans kind of in a historic context or going forward with future planning, no matter what happens or no matter what we do, this event would have happened. It would have created the same amount of destruction. It would have created the same amount of devastation, loss of life, injuries, etc. And there's really nothing we can do. We're kind of powerless in this equation. if we use natural disasters, because it kind of frames this as a natural process that was bound to happen anyway. And this attribution of blame for disasters on nature, or even in insurance terms, as kind of an act of God, what it does is absolves powerful decision makers of responsibility for these decisions. You know, planners, policymakers, government officials, members of Congress, you know, wherever you are in the world, you will have a certain power system that is kind of making these decisions, where to build this development, where to build that road, et cetera, where to set up a new town. These decisions are taken by people in often in positions of power. And actually what it does is we start to see that kind of that responsibility for these decisions shifts away if we continue to use natural as a descriptor for these disaster events. And I think kind of at the core of all of this, you know, the language natural disaster strips these stories of their social, political, environmental, and economic context. You know, there will be very specific vulnerabilities, capacities, social, socioeconomic impacts within a particular town or a city where that disaster is happening, that mean that disaster is, means that hazard has become a disaster. So to use natural really kind of erodes a lot of this context behind why it is that these hazards are turning into disasters in the first place. So I think a key point to remember throughout this entire discussion is, you know, a hazard doesn't have to become a disaster. A hazard, a hazard is a natural process. We will never stop hazards. You know, we will never be able to stop a hurricane. We'll never be able to stop an earthquake, etc. They are here to stay. But what we can do is be in a much better position to prepare for them, to respond to them, and to recover from them. We have lots of technology. We have, particularly in our parts of the world, we're very fortunate in that we have the money, we have the wealth to be able to recover from these events. And actually what we should be saying to ourselves is, are we doing the best job in recovering from these, or even preparing for them, so that actually the risks aren't that great when the hazard first strikes or appears? And I'm just going to kind of run through a couple of reasons why this distinction between hazard and disaster matters, because it does, you know, it's very key to this discussion, and particularly around climate change, with our increasing vulnerability and increasing severity and frequency of these events, particularly atmospheric disasters. We are starting to see a much greater incidence of these types of events. So we need to ask ourselves, well, if a hazard were to impact an area without human habitation or settlements, would that become a disaster? Well, if we go back to the definition that we looked a couple of slides ago, no, it wouldn't, because there's no impact on society or a community. This hazard would really just, you know, remain a hazard. If a hurricane hits a deserted island, by that definition, there is no disaster. It's an event that happens. There's no kind of disaster behind that. If those in charge of planning our towns and our cities do so in a way that protects against those hazards, does it become a disaster? Well, no, it doesn't, because if we build in places, if we allow developments to be built in places that aren't prone to unnecessary risk. And Ron, I really appreciated your point earlier around, you know, this kind of arrogance of humans suggesting that they can build in places and kind of ignore the very kind of natural ingrained natural processes that are occurring, flooding for a key example. If planners and policymakers and town officials, etc., consider these before giving the go-ahead for this planning decisions to be made, then actually we start to see that hazard won't become a disaster, because actually we would have planned in a suitable manner, and we wouldn't be building in places that increase risk. And if we recognize that disasters are at the very core a failure of society to understand and consider vulnerabilities and exposure of certain aspects of a community or a society, then again, these hazards wouldn't turn into disasters. And really, this kind of goes down to the people in positions of power, the you know, the people who are making these decisions and readily putting you know, buildings in areas that are in kind of areas of risk, that we start to see these levels of vulnerability increase and these levels of exposure. Because actually, you know, throughout history, we've seen that those areas that are most at risk will have, you know, maybe a slightly lower economic value. So they can be built on more cheaply, the houses can be sold or rented more cheaply. So you tend to have this kind of diversification of society within these particular areas. And you tend to see a much greater incidence of low to middle income kind of families or individuals being able to afford to live in these areas, even though there is this higher risk of a disaster, of the hazard becoming a disaster. And this kind of goes back to the point that Ron made earlier, actually. You know, this is from the UK. It's a picture of as you can see, a kind of a development billboard for an upcoming housing estate that's being built. Now, it's being built on a floodplain, which, you know, why is that allowed? You know, we have kind of planners and politicians and developers who will push to build on this land because there's an economic opportunity to develop that land. There may be a good rate of return. You know, there may be it might be cheap because it is at risk of flooding. And those risks, although they might be disclosed to the people who are buying those houses, societal, economic, cultural pressures mean that people will still live in them, regardless of the risk, because they are there and because that's where that development was positioned. And eventually those residents will experience a flood event. If we are taking this particular development here as an example, they will experience a flood event. So nothing about that particular process, that chain of events, can be called natural. We chose to build in an area that we knew had a high risk of flooding. We, you know, for whatever reason, made those houses in such a way that weren't resilient to flooding. And the people who live there, although they may have been aware of the risks, you know, because of social and because of cultural constraints, they had no other option than to live in those particular developments. So nothing about that process is natural. It's really all very much focused on decisions that we or the people in positions of power are making for us. And that's where, you know, this idea that this is a natural event is really, you know, it's discredited. It's very core. So summary from those kind of three or four slides is it is really these kind of actions that are taken by, and this is a historical thing. You know, it's been done over many, many decades and centuries. You know, these positions of power make these choices. They make these choices without proper consideration of how vulnerability will increase, of how, you know, the risk level of that particular area of that particular development will increase. And they make these decisions because of, you know, their own benefits or what they see as a wider community benefits at the time, but they haven't given careful consideration to kind of a long-term trend. And we're seeing that more and more with climate change, as David mentioned earlier in his presentation. And they really turn these hazards into a disaster. You know, if we were to build and plan and design in an appropriate way, we would be in a much better position to ensure that those hazards remained just hazards and didn't impact on the functioning and the running of our communities and our societies. So in summary, hazards can be natural, absolutely, but the resulting disasters are almost 99.999% won't be. The decisions that we as a species and as a society make turn those hazards into disasters. The decisions we make as human, and again, as I said, they are often historical, maybe, you know, decades or even centuries ago, the decisions to build in a certain place in a certain location were made, but they are still decisions that we as a society took, even if it was back then, that turned that hazard into a disaster. And going forward in terms of, you know, even kind of the discussion around climate change, you know, poor political planning, economic, technological decisions are making disasters for the future. You know, COP26, unfortunately, really didn't do much in the way of driving forward the mitigation necessary to meet, you know, a number of the challenges that we're experiencing through climate change. And they are effectively creating the disasters of tomorrow by this lack of agreement, this lack of policy direction, of policy focus, etc. And using natural to describe these disasters gives these powerful decision makers a free pass in some circumstances to force people to live in these extra vulnerable or extra risk-ridden parts of the world, you know, parts of a country or community, and really transfers that blame from themselves, from those decisions that they are making, maybe knowingly, maybe not, but really transfers that back onto nature, which just isn't true. And I hope that through these slides, you can understand that there is a very human focus to a lot of the decisions that cause these disasters in the first place. So that's my presentation. There is really nothing natural about a disaster. I hope you have some questions and we can have some good debates. If you do want to find out more resource or kind of have a read through our literature, please visit the website. It's all free to use, free to download, free to share. Thank you so much for your time.
It sounds like you're inviting a debate.
Well, I mean, you know, unfortunately, we do this type of discussion does tend to have, you know, this kind of aspect of people being a little bit taken aback to begin with, which I think is just natural. You know, it's part of the natural process of trying to push forward these types of discussions, I think.
Yeah, I agree. So if, again, if people would like to ask a question, you can raise your hand. Or if you're more comfortable, go ahead and put it in the chat and I'll monitor that. Kevin, I have a question for you to start it off.
Sure.
Based on, what is one of the most common, when you say, you know, there's been some debate about this, maybe what's one of the more common questions or debates that you would get from people back at you?
Yeah, I mean, it's really different for different audiences. I think that the main one, or the most common one, I should say, is the discussion around meteorite strikes. So obviously what we're saying is a disaster isn't natural, because effectively what we can do is we can plan for that event and we can mitigate the risk to a certain degree that means that that hazard won't become a disaster. And what we tend to get in this discussion is people saying, well, you know, if a meteorite strikes the planet, that's not something we can plan for. And actually only a couple of weeks ago, there was a near miss of a meteorite kind of passing by Earth relatively close. I mean, obviously they're still hundreds of thousands of miles away, but, you know, in space terms, that's close. And we didn't see it because it came in the direction of the sun. So we didn't see it really until it kind of passed by. And people use the argument, well, that we can't plan for, and that would, to a degree, be a natural disaster, because there's nothing we can do as a society. We can't choose to build somewhere else. We can't, you know, build stronger buildings, etc., to protect against that. But my kind of argument to that, and we've spoken with people at NASA about this, we've actually had this discussion with NASA, is if you think about the rate at which technological advances are happening in terms of trying to scan the sky to kind of understand where these objects of concern are, the same thing could be said for our understanding of hurricanes 200 years ago. You know, we are probably in the same position as people's understanding of hurricanes were 200 years ago as we are now with meteorites. And that will change over time. You know, our technology, our ability to scan the sky will get better over time. And therefore, you know, it will be one of these things again that we're able to plan for, and we're able to mitigate against those risks as best we can.
We have a question from Sarah Pollan.
Oh, great.
She says, hi, Kevin.
Hello.
The photo of you showed off the new home development sign in a wetland area of standing water in the UK was shrinking.
Yes,
it was. And she said, I know that municipal community planning in the UK is fairly unique and well controlled. Do you see the culture around planning changing to avoid building in hazardous areas? That's one part. And part two is, do you think there will be any lessons we can take from that that will apply in Canada?
I mean, it's a fantastic question, Sarah. Thank you very much. I think I used to work for an organization called Flood Re in the UK, which is the kind of government-backed reinsurance organization to kind of try and combat flood risk. And you know, part of our work there was to really kind of try and understand how these development processes kind of happen and why it is that developers choose to build in certain areas. The economic viability of these areas is a big part of that. You know, the more risky the land, the cheaper it tends to be, and the kind of greater return you can get for your investment. But yes, Sarah, absolutely. You know, it is fairly well controlled, but to a degree. So there's a you know, the guidance that the national government, i.e. the kind of government in Westminster, gives, and then how that is translated by local authorities and local planning authorities differs. And actually the Environment Agency, which is our organization, government organization here, that's kind of in charge of flooding and reducing the risk of flooding, can advise on not to build in a particular area, but it can't enforce it. It only has a certain amount of power. So although, you know, the Environment Agency as an organization can say, actually, this is a high risk area, you really shouldn't be developing this, if the local planning authority decides to override that, then they can in effect do that. And really, it's that kind of economic benefit thing again. You know, it's kind of, you know, local planners, local authorities will want this investment in housing and infrastructure, et cetera, within their particular area of focus. So it really does push these kind of decisions into a more risk, kind of open to risk, for want of a better term. In terms of kind of the Canadian example, I to be honest, I don't really know much about the Canadian system. I hope that you would have a stronger system whereby if your environmental regulator were to say, do not build on this land, it's very risky, I hope that would be enough to stop that development happening. But again, like I say, I don't really understand enough about the Canadian system to comment. Apologies.
Maybe just to follow on that, we have a hand up and we have a question in the chat, but I just think it would be helpful to maybe explain a little bit more about why it matters in policy if you write something as a natural disaster versus that we have control over. Like, how does that matter with maybe how funds are allocated?
Yes. Yeah, and I think you've kind of hit the nail on the head there, Laura. I think it is really about how funds are allocated. You know, if a policymaker or a politician or, you know, someone in kind of a position whereby there can be funding associated based on what it is that they're advising, you know, if they say a natural disaster as opposed to something that we can actually have control over, that changes the funding dynamics, you know, immediately of that project. So it may well be that, you know, and you can kind of view this two ways. You can either view it as politicians not wanting to use natural disaster because they understand, you know, they have a role to play in building resilience, reducing capacity, reducing exposure, etc. But sometimes politicians, and I'm not suggesting any politicians in the UK or any in Canada or anywhere would do this, but sometimes they do. They may choose to use natural disaster because, again, it kind of allows this kind of this theory that it's a natural process. And no matter what we do, no matter how much money we spend, these things are going to happen. So we should just build wherever we want and allow these risks to be kind of part of the process of that. So, yeah, it's absolutely important when it comes down to kind of terminology use in policy and legislation.
Thank you for that. We have a question from Guy, who's with the Canadian Red Cross, who is actually in community in Fort McMurray. So go over to
Hello, you. Good morning. Just, it's more like a couple of thoughts. One is, it just strikes me like the history of this country was founded on basically the colonial approach was fur trade. So where did the fur traders go? All along the rivers. So now we have a whole range of communities in the Northwest Territories and across Canada where actually Indigenous communities have developed their communities along the river and they're vulnerable to those. So it's just somehow recognizing that's part of our history, and it's to be able to shift, I guess, the narrative. But the other thing, we need psychologists on this file, because all the things you're talking about makes me hear people say, okay, that's the left libs talking about that stuff. I saw on Twitter a couple of days ago, someone, a rancher in BC who was flooded, and he was describing how horrible it was. And he says his last statement was, I hope we're not going to make this thing about climate change. So there's something psychological about basically what all of what we're asking people to take responsibility for changes, but at the same time, responsibility for the errors that have been made. So to me, it's a collective thing. And now with the COVID stuff and the mandates and everything, even more government regulation. So there's really, it's really a political hot mess, but there's a psychological thing. Like, people have a hard time accepting that the vehicles they drive contribute to climate change. Like, it's because then you have to be guilty. So I don't know, do you have any insight on the psychology of this by chance?
Thanks. No, I mean, I mean, it's a great point. And actually it's well understood within our community that yes, this is, it's very much a kind of a psychological argument. It's about trying to, you know, get people to understand that this isn't nature. These really are our discussion, our decisions that are creating these risks. And you're absolutely right. It does go back to, you know, we do sometimes get called kind of lefty, liberal, hippies, you know, whatever, you know, wanting to talk too much about the fluffy stuff, which is, you know, that's fine. Like, that's political discourse in the 21st century, I guess. But I would, to that and to kind of any broader accusation that, you know, we're kind of trying to place the blame on kind of society as a whole. And I hope I made this clear in my presentation. This isn't about Joe blogs on the streets or Jane blogs on the streets. This is about people who have the power to do something about it. And that's what our campaign is really focused on. It's about changing, you know, mass media, about changing politicians' views, about changing planners to try and get these risks kind of realized. Joe blogs and Jane blogs, yes, they have a part to play in terms of kind of, you know, their impacts on climate change, but that's kind of maybe a separate discussion. But for them to use natural disaster, that's not really going to matter. You know, if they use natural disaster in their kind of day-to-day conversation with colleagues, etc., it's not really going to have that bigger effect. What is going to have an effect is the people who are in positions of power. And if we can get them to change their minds, then eventually that kind of strategy and that focus on reducing risk instead of just acknowledging them, hopefully will, you know, start to trickle down to wider society.
Oh, maybe a follow-up comment for me. You may mention something. So here in Fort McMurray, the floodplain where I was evacuated for 6 months, so I know what it feels like, I'm just saying, there were conversations of, you know, of buying out property and all that stuff. And then the price tag starts hitting, right? How much it's going to cost. There's no long-term funding models, because actually, if you think that there's an average of a flood here every 30 some years, and it's like an expensive flood, it's not a cheap flood, right? Yeah. So I'm agreeing with all you're saying, but it's to get people to think longer term, larger, and not just short term. And and the political stuff is usually more short term. So anyways, thank you for your work. I just wanted to share that.
100% agree. I think you're right. And our political system, you know, tends to be 4 or 5 year terms. So a politician will only ever be looking that far in advance. You know, really, they're not really kind of focused about what's going to happen after they leave office or after they lose an election. So yes, absolutely. I, that kind of funding stream and funding strategy does need to change for this to be, you know, to be workable. Thank you.
Thanks, Kevin and Guy. We have a question from Cheryl. I see your hand is up. You also had something in the chat, but since your hand is up, maybe if you want to unmute and go ahead and ask your question.
Thank you. All of this is quite fascinating. Something that I've been thinking about lately regarding the land use planning and insurance piece, it relates to your example, Kevin, about in the UK, the federal government can set up sort of best practice guidelines for where to build, where not to build, etc. But then the local jurisdiction can override it. what I'm always interested in looking at the power, the money, the personal benefit, but also legal liability. So for example, in and personal legal liability. Mm-hmm. So in your example where the local jurisdiction, say local council approves a development, yeah. If there is a catastrophic loss there, are those local councillors personally held responsible for approving that that development? And do they have to provide compensation in any way? And I suspect I know the answer, and I suspect
I think you probably do.
This is where the massive gap is.
Yeah, and you probably know what I'm going to say. No, they don't. So that's why the British government have tried to push this onto the private sector. So they introduced FloodRe as an organization, which is kind of has a 34-year remit. It was set up in 2010, I believe, has 34 years to effectively make sure that private homeowners, multiple homeowners in some cases, have private insurance to cover losses from flooding, so that it removes the risk from government and from local authority.
Removes the direct responsibility for their actions,
basically,
and passes it off to an external party so that they can continue to directly benefit. And I think this is at the crux of all of this. If you can keep avoiding direct responsibility for decisions that are made, and you continue to have direct personal and local benefit, why would you change exactly. your decision-making? It is actually a disincentive. Mm-hmm. So I think that we can ask all these questions, dance all around, but the power structure and the direct legal liability, financial responsibility for these decisions, until that is directly put back on the shoulders of those responsible for making those decisions and directly benefiting from those decisions, I'm not feeling very hopeful. The idea that you're going to create more insurance, more awareness, yes, blah, 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 but if you ignore the fundamental power structure, and how those relationships are emboldened and continue to be funded and supported in a variety of ways, I think you're just kind of wasting
time. What, us personally, the campaign?
That's what I'm feeling these days. Like after COP, I'm just like...
You mean us, the campaign is wasting time, or just...
So that unless... we ask some of these deeper questions and address some of these deeper structural power imbalances that we're not directing all the efforts that are needed to actually address the problems long term.
Yeah, and which is why, you know, our campaign is very much focused on those who have those you know, powerful positions, who are able to make those changes. You know, just very quickly back to FloodRe, they do have a cutoff date. So any development that was approved after a certain date won't be allowed to join the scheme. So you won't be able to get cheaper insurance to do that. But obviously, you know, everything before that is able to join the scheme, you know, and benefit from cheaper insurance rates. So it's still passing that on to a private sector. But I absolutely take your point. I think, you know, Cheryl, what you've said is true, you know, that the power structures, the systems that are in place currently aren't sustainable. And that's hopefully what our campaign is starting to raise awareness about as well, in a very small way, because obviously this goes much bigger than just disaster processes. But we are trying to target those people who have the power to stop this and to stop these kind of abuses of power and to stop these kind of almost corrupt systems, you know.
And ironically, it's you're asking those people in power to agree to take on financial and legal responsibility and to reduce their power. So it's like, see why this is challenging.
Yeah, it is incredibly challenging. It's a very slow process. You know, we're like, not expecting overnight wins.
I don't want to do that. No, thank you. Thank you. Yeah. No.
But I think, you know, I think with a greater awareness of these types of issues, you know, going, if we're kind of using the mass media as an example, a greater awareness of some of the core risks behind these disasters, hopefully, you know, members of the public will start to kind of appreciate the kind of the systems that are in place currently. And, you know, change can happen. It's always very, very slow, very painful to get there, but it can happen. And we're hoping we'll be a tiny part of that.
Okay. Thank you.
Great. Thanks, Kevin. Thank you, Cheryl, for bringing that up. We have a comment from Sarah Walsh with the Canadian Red Cross, and then also a comment and question, and then Brooklyn will be next. Okay. So Sarah is saying that she thinks language, especially in policy, really matters. I think we can agree on that. There's a lot of evidence, too, in the policy literature to support this. She thanks you, Kevin, for bringing this to our attention. Is there any formal mechanism for joining the campaign, or is it more informal if somebody wanted to get more involved?
Yeah, there's no formal kind of procedure. Just if you want to get involved, please visit the website. There's lots of tools and resources on there on how you can broach this subject with colleagues, with your managers, you know, with people, again, in positions of power, how you can start to have this discussion. There are tools for, you know, promoting this idea on social media, etc. But yeah, if you want to engage and please, you know, just feel free to do so. There's no formal structure to it.
Great. And I'll put a link in the chat.
Awesome. Thank you.
Your website as well. And then over to you, Brooklyn.
Sounds good. Thanks so much, Kevin, for bringing this idea up. And I think the power of language is so important. And like, it's really interesting to hear about it on a policy level. That's definitely like opened my eyes to how important it is to talk about things in the right terms. But and kind of on that note that Guy brought up, I think what I've been thinking about a lot recently is, you know, how to connect people on these polarizing topics like climate change that have become so political, that it's like so foundational to our, you know, life on this planet. And I think like one thing that I came across is really trying to connect with people's values and finding common ground, I think is something that we can try to do, and not really bringing up like polarizing language, but really trying to connect to community values and people's values, I think can be like a good starting ground, which is hard to do in practice. It's very hard in practice. But one thing I found really inspiring was this project that came out of Alberta, which is the Alberta Narratives Project, which I'll share in the chat with all of you. And it basically went around to a lot of different communities and connected with people from different sectors, like agriculture, oil and gas sector, and like how to talk about climate change with different groups that may have different political views as you. And I think the key thing that they found was connecting to values was really important. So I just thought I would share that with everyone on the chat here.
Great, thank you.
It doesn't look like there's any more questions. So if that's it, then I guess we can thank, or David had to leave, unfortunately, but Kevin, thank you so much for sharing you. This information with us. And then I'll pass it over to Shauna now with views, just for final words.
Yeah, thank you so much. I feel like we had some great conversation there and some great questions. And thank you, Kevin, Laura, and David. It was really insightful. So I guess we'll go ahead and close. I do want to say I do apologize if there were some participants that received a link late. I think we do have a little kink in our database system with sending it the link. So I do want to apologize if you were one of those participants that did receive it super late. So thank you all for joining, and hopefully we'll see you at the next session, which will take place, I believe, at the end of January. Thank you.